We bend our knees, O Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. O Lord, we cast down our idols and give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Bow our hearts, we bend our knees. O Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. O Lord, we cast down our idols. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be that generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob. So give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another.
Seek your face tonight, God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give us clean hands, oh God. Give us pure hearts tonight, Jesus, we pray. Let us worship you, Lord, with a pure vessel. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God.
Father, I love you. My heart is filled with desire to see your power and glory cover the earth as the waters clothe the sea. And I am surrounded by the fortress of God. I'm totally surrendered to you. Oh, Father, I love you. My heart is filled with desire to see your power and glory cover the earth as the waters clothe the sea. And I am surrounded by the fortress of God, and I'm totally surrendered to you. I lift up my hands, standing unashamed. I worship you, Father, exalting your name. You've captured my heart, now my life has changed. I lift up my hands. I lift up my hands. And Father, I love you. And my heart is filled with desire to see your power and your glory cover the earth as the waters clothe the sea. And I am surrounded by the fortress of God, and I'm totally surrendered to you. I lift up my hands, standing unashamed. I worship you, Father, exalting your name. You captured my heart, my life has changed. I lift up my hands. I lift up my hands. I lift up my hands, standing unashamed. My hands.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. God, we worship your holy name. We bless you tonight, Father. Hallelujah, Jesus. Let us hunger, Lord, and desire for your presence, your spirit, your glory tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Search for all eternity, Lord, and find.
hallelujah to the King. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Our worship tonight creates the atmosphere where His presence can come in and dwell among us. Amen. When we lift up our hands and we surrender our hearts to Him, that invites His presence. He wants to be with us. He wants to dwell with us. He wants to bless us with His Spirit and His presence. And it's through our praise and our effort in worship, amen, that creates that atmosphere that invites His presence to come in and to dwell among us. So thankful to feel the presence of the Lord tonight. Amen. One more song of worship before Pastor comes tonight. Amen.
Worship the King. Worship the King. We are in His presence to magnify His name. It's when we seek His face, His glory fills this place as we worship the King.
I'll sing this familiar song tonight.
Worship the King. Worship the King. We are in His presence to magnify His name. It's when we seek His face, His glory fills this place as we
God, we praise You tonight. God, we worship You. We thank You, Jesus. We thank You, dear Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. How wonderful to be in the presence of the Lord tonight. Why don't we just love Him together tonight? Hallelujah. God, we love You tonight. We praise You. We worship You, oh God. How excellent, how marvelous tonight to be in Your presence, oh God. Feel your touch, Lord. Oh, God, better a day in thy courts than a thousand. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. And it's so wonderful tonight to be together in the house of the Lord and to be able to worship God in spirit and in truth together tonight. We want to remind everyone that our prayer-focused church this week is the Life Tabernacle in Langley, and Pastor and Sister Lemke tonight, and the good folks there in our sister church in the city of Langley. Amen. We need to remember to hold one another up in prayer tonight. And so if you have a need tonight and we begin to pray, why don't you call that need out to the Lord? Amen. Mention that situation, that individual. Amen. And let God move in their situation through your prayers tonight. Praise God. Let's pray together tonight. Lord Jesus, we thank you, God, for your goodness, Lord, for your mercy tonight. How wonderful tonight to have the opportunity to come together into your presence, O God, and to worship you and to feel your presence tonight. Lord Jesus, we pray for our sister church tonight, the city of Langley. God, that you would be with them tonight and be with Pastor Lord and Sister Lemke tonight. Let God, your presence, your spirit, minister to them tonight, Lord. God, we know tonight that there are needs scattered around tonight among your people. Lord, we pray tonight, God, for each one, each name that's called, each situation that's represented tonight. Lord Jesus, tonight, you are the one tonight who can work, Lord, in our lives, can do what is beyond our ability and scope tonight. God, we pray tonight that your work would be accomplished tonight in each situation. Your will would be accomplished tonight, we pray. And Lord, we pray that God, you would lift up your people tonight in your presence, O God, as we worship you and as we call upon your name tonight. Oh God, lift us up into your presence in a very special way. Thank you tonight, God. Thank you for being with us tonight. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for allowing your spirit, Lord, to minister in our hearts and in our lives tonight. Praise God. We praise you tonight. We praise you tonight. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. I want to turn tonight to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 9. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 9. Now, if you came tonight just wanting a little morsel, just be fed a little bit spiritually, is probably not going to be too exciting tonight. Amen. I came here tonight to challenge us, not only those of us that are assembled here in the house tonight, but those of you that may be watching online. I believe that God wants to challenge us tonight and wants us to consider the work of God as a whole, God's work in this earth. You know, there's nothing more important happening in this world than the work of God, than what God's doing right now. Amen. Among his people and in this world, those that he's drawing. The scripture says no one comes to God except the Spirit draw him. And God is drawing people who are hungry tonight. And it's exciting tonight to know that God is working in our world tonight. And he's working in our lives tonight. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 9 says, "For we are laborers together with God." Notice this. We are laborers together with God. You are God's husbandry. You are God's building. Amen. We are laborers together with God. And then I want to turn tonight to the book of Mark chapter 8, a recording of the Lord Jesus' challenge and call to his disciples. And in verse 34 of Mark chapter 8, it says, "And when he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whosoever shall save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. Amen. Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. My subject tonight is the discovery, finding a burden for the cause of Christ. Amen. Finding a burden for the cause of Christ. Now, this term burden is something that is not so widely used anymore in today's vernacular. The term itself was widely used in the turn of the century, the 20th century church, when the outpouring of the Holy Spirit came again into full fruition, and people began to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit in the early 1900s. And this resurgence of what happened in Acts chapter 2 coming back full circle into the operation of the Spirit within the church. And out of that came certain impulses. You can see in the book of Acts, there were certain impulses of the Spirit that happened when the day of Pentecost took place. This is also the same phenomena that happened when the turn of the century Pentecostals began to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, just as had happened in the upper room. There were impulses of the Spirit that began to grip the people of God. These people came out of all manner of different Christian backgrounds, realizing that God was leading them to an experience that was still to be provided. And when they were filled with the Spirit, God began to lead the people. He led them to not only the receiving of the Spirit, speaking with tongues as the Spirit of God gave utterance. The Spirit led them to holiness, living, and Christian principles. It led them also to the evangelization of the lost. This was an impulse of the Spirit. This was a last day impulse, one that is still in operation today, should still be pulsating through the very heart of the church. One of the language words that was used widely in the early days of this resurgence and experience was this old-fashioned term called a burden. When it was used not as in the classic use of the term as far as in a verb, where it's referring to a weight or being weighed down with a load, but it was used in the form of a noun, which meant to bear something or to convey something. It meant to carry something, and this was a word that was used within the early church of the 20th century, where people would refer to the leading of the Spirit until they became heavy with responsibility, heavy with desire, heavy, amen, to see something accomplished in the kingdom of God. The cause of Christ became that which was uppermost in their thinking. They lived lives, yes. They had responsibilities, yes. They went about their living as they must. But there came to this early 20th century church a great expectation a certain understanding that God had called them into the greatest thing that the world had ever known to that particular point. This is the wonderful kingdom of God. And what a wonderful calling that is tonight. Amen. What a wonderful thing tonight to be able to have this wonderful blessing of being part of what God is doing in this hour. Amen. And so they would call this impulse of the Spirit having a burden or getting a burden. And it was something that drove them and caused them to seek deeply the things of God and allow God's will to be expressed in their lives. Amen. And so tonight I want to talk to us for a few moments about finding a burden for the cause of Christ. There's never been a day or an hour or a time that it's more necessary to become impassioned for the things of God than today. Amen. Our world needs, amen, a church that is on fire. Our world needs a church that is consumed with a passion for the things of Christ, the cause of Christ, the winning of souls. And this is so important tonight for us to understand, because we live in a very dangerous hour, an hour of great deception. And that deception is trying to find its way into the minds and the hearts of the people of God. Amen. Finding a burden for the cause of Christ begins with passion. Amen. Passion for Jesus Christ. A passion that is born out of thanksgiving. A deep-seated thankfulness that emanates from us. Amen. Understanding what God has done for us. I suppose one of the things that makes it difficult in our day and time to understand and to be impassioned about what God has done in our lives is the fact that we have lost our revelation of lostness. Without Christ, we are lost. Without Jesus Christ, people are lost. They're not just less fortunate. They're not just less blessed than you are. They are lost without Christ, and we are lost without Christ. And one of the things we need to hold on to is that moment of understanding and revelation when we first bowed our knee to God of our lostness. We need Jesus Christ. We need Him in our lives. We need Him to save us. And oh, friend, tonight, amen, when you have that revelation, there comes to you a automatic thankfulness, because the Lord hath picked us up out of our lowest state, our sinful estate, taken us from the miry clay and lifted us up on the rock, Christ Jesus. Amen. When we fall in love with Jesus Christ, we began to be affected by that which He loves. Amen. I said, if when we fall in love with Jesus, we should automatically become affected by the things that God loves. Amen. Now today, this is an essence that is lost today in our world. And the world in which we live has made many attempts, and successfully many times, to inundate us with so much, so many things, so many distractions that we forget that we should become passionate about the things of God, passionate about Jesus Christ. Amen. We are bombarded every day. And there seems to, in our world for sure, and sometimes even in the church, be a sense that there is a lack of passion, the lack of ability to have passion. We're so distracted. There are so many things presented to us every day. There's so many choices brought into our life. But I'm here tonight to talk to you about the one thing that every one of us who have been saved by Jesus Christ Christ should have, and that's a passion for Jesus Christ and a passion for the things of God and a passion for the cause of Christ. Amen. We cannot love God and not become impassioned about the things that He is impassioned about. Amen. And all of us are affected. Not one person in this room that's not affected by our world that we live in and being distracted. I don't think anybody here tonight would not want to be involved in the things of God. But we're just so bombarded every day, thrust into situations and choices and decisions and so on. And sometimes we've just got to stop and push it all aside for a few moments and get back at the feet of Jesus and let us remember what it was that Jesus did for us, taking us out of our sinful condition and bringing us to a place of wonderful salvation and changing the parameters of our life and washing us and making us new creatures in Christ Jesus. Oh, I think tonight we need to just push it all aside sometimes and just sit at His feet for a few moments and let that realization come back into our hearts so we understand again what Jesus has done for us. Amen. Our world has served up its banquet table full of distractions. But I'm here tonight to say there's a discovery that Jesus Christ wants every one of us to have, and that's discovering, amen, what it means to be a co-laborer with Christ, to be laborers together with Christ, to be joined together in the same purpose, with the same harmony, with the same heartbeat. And if we could do that tonight, oh, what a difference it would make in the world that surrounds each of our lives and in the world at large, because it's hard to hold back somebody that is impassioned with a burden for the cause of Jesus Christ. Amen. When we look at Jesus Christ, Jesus was in burden and impassioned for all mankind. John 3:16, we can all quote it. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but should have everlasting life. 2 Peter 3:9, not willing, He said, that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. This is what Jesus Christ is about. This is still the day of salvation. This is still the day, amen, of the church. This is still the day in which God is reaching into the hearts and the lives of men. And there are people in this world that need to know that there is a God that is impassioned for them. And how are they going to know that if they see no passion from God's people? Amen. There are principally three types of Christians that I want to mention tonight. First of all, there's the Christian of convenience. We see this very readily in our Christian world in general. They are more concerned with what God can do for them, and they're willing to observe Christianity and identification with Christ as long as it does not cost them or hamper their lives. This is, amen, the Christian of convenience. It's a Christian that is a Christian when it is convenient for them to become or to be or to declare to be a Christian. And then there is the functionary Christian. The functionary Christian just does what is expected of them. No more, no less. It's not an overly engaged individual. And they're there. They have a certain sense of propriety of what is expected, and they're willing to do it. They are functional in their relationship with God. Usually, these people must be asked to do something, prodded to do something, encouraged to do something for Jesus Christ. They are functional. They will do if they're asked or if they're prodded, but they do not self-engage. They do not take take the experience in Christ, like taking a bull by the horns and just really getting engaged in it. And it never really captures this individual's passion. Church is church. Christianity, functional, want to be saved, but not interested in doing much more than what is expected of me. And then there is the impassioned disciple of Christ. This disciple of Christ who is impassioned is compelled by the Spirit to be part of the cause of Jesus Christ because of their love for Him. Amen. This individual, this disciple, spends time seeking God's will and expression in their lives, looks for ways and avenues to be involved in the things that God is involved in, never needs prodding or to be asked. Or to have expectation thrust upon them. Amen. When involved in ministry, in the work of God, they find, amen, a level of responsibility and burden because they seek after it. And that usually leads from one thing into even more deeper work of God in their life. They take ownership, and God becomes their cause. The things of God becomes their life. His work becomes their work. This is what we're talking about tonight. The impassioned disciple of Christ, amen, who is compelled by the Spirit to go a little deeper than the average, to seek out God's will and to know what God wants to work in their lives. You see, God wants to use every one of us here tonight. He wants to use us in a specific way and a specific fashion. We do not always know what that is, and it is a journey of discovery. Amen. It's a journey of discovery. So, as in every cooking recipe or baking recipe, there are certain ingredients that are to be found. I want to talk to you tonight just for a few moments, amen, about this burden. There is a recipe and there are ingredients that bring a burden to pass in our lives. Amen. First of all, there is a sense of thanksgiving, a deep sense of thanksgiving for what God has done in our lives. Colossians chapter 2, verse 7 says, rooted and builded up in Him and established in the faith as you have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Oh, friend, the Apostle Paul warned us of the last days when they would be unthankful, and that was coupled together with unholy, yet having a form of godliness, but denying the power of God in their lives. Oh, we need to have thankfulness in our lives, and from that thanksgiving will arise some wonderful things. Colossians chapter 4, verse 2 says to continue you in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving. The second ingredient I want to mention is responsibility. Understanding this principle of the Scripture, to whom much is given, much more is required. Jesus says this to us in Luke chapter 12 and verse 48, unto whomsoever is much given, of him shall be much required. And to whom men have committed much, of him will they ask the more. There is a certain expectation, a responsibility that should come to every believer when the Lord God has reached into our lives and done such a marvelous work. Responsibility must be found in us to understand we have been given much, so also we must mete out much of our life. Amen. Then, of course, in our text tonight, there is a willingness to give, born of thankfulness, born of responsibility. There should come a spirit of willingness to give our lives to Christ and to His cause. For whosoever shall save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. Amen. A willingness to be involved, a co-labor with Christ. Hey, folks, we're in this together tonight. Amen. It's you and Jesus, and we're in this together. Amen. We are fellow laborers with Him. And then the next ingredient is the willingness to spend time in searching for God's will to be done in our lives. Matthew 6 and 9 and 10 says, after this manner, therefore pray ye, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Amen. This is the desire to know God's will in our life. One of the things that has stood me well growing up in the church is that as far back as I can remember, I always was aware that God had something in mind for my life. God had a plan. Amen. He had a will to express. Now, I didn't always want to obey His will, but I always had the understanding that God has a design. God has a plan. Amen. God, if you could see what God had in mind for you, it would probably startle you. It would amaze you, because God has things designed for your life to use you for His glory. I'm sure tonight that we circumvent many of the things that God has planned and mapped out in our life because we want to do things our way and go our way. But the ingredient of a burden comes out of the search for God's will in our life. Every day we should say, not our will, but Your will, God. Amen. Not what I want, oh God, but what You want tonight. Hallelujah. That should be our prayer every day of our life. Every day of our life. Oh, what a difference it makes when you're involved in ministry. If you're a functional disciple of Christ, if you're a functional individual, you just go about your responsibility. You go about your work because it's been thrust upon you, perhaps, or there was a need. But to that individual that actually finds that place of burden in their life, amen. Oh, what a difference that makes. Amen. Teaching children in Sunday school makes a big difference if you have a burden. Amen. Preaching or teaching Bible studies, seeking to work with people. It is altogether different if you have a burden or if you're just doing it because your conscience tells us that we should. We need tonight to discover, amen, what it means again to have a burden upon us. Amen. A certain conveyance of God's cause thrust upon us, and understand that this is what I have been called to. The Christian of convenience never knows anything deeper than what they deem will affect them. The functionary Christian never knows the joys of being a co-laborer together with Christ. The impassioned disciple of Christ finds the true joy of partnering with Jesus Christ and being part of His cause. There should be no greater joy in your life, amen, than what God is allowing you to be part of and to do. And if you can become impassioned for that in your life, if you can let God, amen, impassion your heart and your life for what He has called you to do, amen, you're going to find and discover that there's a burden that comes upon your life, and that burden will drive you. Amen. It will cause you to see, amen, God's cause go forward in every way conceivable. Amen. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 5, but watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. For he said, I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. And I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, he said, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me that day, and not to me only, but unto all them that love his appearing. Amen. There is a crown of righteousness to be won tonight. Amen. Amen. I know tonight that we look at heaven as being the utopia, and I do believe that heaven is going to be a great experience, but we need to understand that there is things that we carry with us from this life into the next. Amen. And the Lord God allows certain things to be visited upon your life. Those things will not be diminished when you cross the threshold of what we call life. When you enter into the presence of God, you will carry those things with you. Amen. The result of giving your life to Christ in a deeper and greater sense than many others in our world today, even within the confines of Christendom. Amen. There is something here tonight to be won with your life. Your life can reap a crown of righteousness. And what kind of crowns do we have tonight that we're going to cast before his feet tonight? It is only those which we carry with us from this particular life. Amen. There is a crown of righteousness, the apostle said, that is laid in store for us tonight. Oh, friend, tonight, why do we do what we do? I don't want to live without passion in my life. I don't want to live a dull, dreary, functional life. I want to be alive. Hallelujah. I want to feel deeply. I want to care deeply. I want to be moved greatly. Amen. I want to experience, amen, the fullness of life in Jesus Christ. I don't just want a prosperity God. I don't just want, amen, a God that will do whatever I want him to do for me. I want a God that I can share with. Amen. A God that I can be co-laborers together with. A God, amen, that allows me to be part of what he is doing in this hour. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm here tonight to tell you and to challenge us and those of you that are watching online tonight. Amen. It's a high time for us to regain our passion in Christ. This COVID business has sapped some of us. It has caused us to get derailed. It has changed our faith and our practices. Amen. I'm here tonight to tell you, amen, that God wants you to rekindle tonight your passion for Christ, your passion for the things of God, your passion for the work of God. Amen. He wants you to carry a burden tonight for the things that he is about tonight. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, don't let us just go through the motions. Let us not just be functional disciples, but let us be, amen, impassioned disciples tonight. Amen. That are busy about being what Jesus Christ is about tonight. Let's stand together tonight. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus said in the scripture, amen, take my yoke upon you, learn of me, amen. His yoke is, yes, it is a burden, but it's easy and it's light. It's easy and it's light. Oh, hallelujah. Praise God. Tonight, the Lord Jesus Christ is calling us back to a place of impassioned burden for the things of God, for the kingdom of God, for the work of God. Oh, there's still people. There's still time for people to be saved. There's still opportunity tonight. I don't know how long we have till the coming of the Lord. It may not be very long, but whatever time we have, I want to be busy about doing what Jesus Christ is about. Amen. Jesus, even from the age of 12, said, I must be about my Father's business. Amen. And he said of his waning, in his waning days of ministry, I must do the works of him that sent me while it's day, for the night cometh when no man can work. Amen. Impassion. Capturing a burden. Amen. If you really think about it, we will have to admit that this last year and a half has sapped some things out of the church. And of course, when we talk about the church, we're talking about the people of God. But oh, it's time for us tonight to recapture, to get it back. Amen. To get red hot in our experience with God. Amen. And to become passionate again about the things of God. Don't be guilty tonight of being more passionate about what happens in your day-to-day life than what happens when we come together in the house of the Lord, or when you have an opportunity to share with somebody, or have a Bible study with somebody, or, amen, to help somebody in a time of crisis and need. I'm here tonight to tell you that's why we're here. That's why the Lord did not take you when you were first saved and say, well, that's all you need to do. He left you here so that you could be a fellow laborer with him, so that you could join him and be part of what God is doing in this hour. Amen. I don't want to have to be that individual that's got to be prodded, that's got to be pleaded with, that's got to be asked and put on guilt trips to do something for God. I want to do something for God because I love Jesus Christ. Amen. Because I'm consumed with the things that he's consumed with. Oh, hallelujah. Could we, amen, just take a few moments tonight and recommit ourselves, amen, once again to that passion that we once had in our lives for Jesus Christ and for the things of God. Amen. Let's talk to him tonight and invite him to be part of what we're doing in this hour. Hallelujah. To be part of whatever he's about tonight. Oh, hallelujah, God. Lord, tonight we want, oh God, to be your people. We want to be part of what you are a part of tonight. Oh God, we want to be used of God tonight. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh God, we worship you tonight. Lord, we thank you for what you've done in our lives. We thank you tonight, God, for picking us up out of the miry clay and setting our feet and establishing us, oh God, and Lord Jesus, changing our lives and making us new creatures in Christ Jesus. Oh God, we're so thankful tonight. But Lord Jesus, in our thanksgiving, God, we also accept the responsibility tonight, oh God, of your work tonight, of being part of your kingdom tonight. Hallelujah. Being a fellow laborer with you tonight. Oh God, tonight we thank you for it tonight. We thank you for it. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. Oh, thank you, Jesus. God, we want you to use us tonight. We want you to use us tonight in a special way. Oh, God, we want you to use us tonight. Hallelujah. Let us be a part of what you're doing in this hour tonight. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We thank you tonight, Jesus. We thank you tonight. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. Amen, amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. I want to be involved with what he is doing in this hour. Praise God. Amen. I want to be used of God. I want, amen, to be a fellow laborer with Jesus Christ. I want to take his yoke upon me. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. It's time for us to challenge ourselves, amen, to step up to the next level and to leave our status quo behind. Amen. We've kind of fallen into the rut, fallen into certain habits that are not our norm. But I'm here tonight to say to you, God's got a work that's happening. God's got a work that's going on. And we ought to position ourselves. Everything we do, every choice we make, every decision that we make, amen, we need to make it with God's will in mind in our lives. Praise God. Oh, hallelujah. Can we love Him one more time tonight? Hallelujah. Thank Him for His presence tonight. Oh, God, we thank You tonight. Thank You for Your presence tonight. You are so good tonight. Oh, God. Hallelujah. We're excited to see what You're going to do in this hour. We're excited to see, Lord, Your hand at work. Oh, God, lead us tonight to a higher place in You. Lead us to a deeper walk. Oh, God, we pray in Jesus' wonderful name. In Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. God bless you tonight. And as we go, let's remember all of our regular service are in-house. And for those of you that have not had the opportunity or have made an opportunity to be back to the house of God, I want to encourage you to do that because we need to be together to worship God. The church cannot be the church that God intends for it to be when we are scattered and we are not living together in purpose. And so we invite everybody to be back in the house of worship. Regular services Sunday morning, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock worship, and Saturday praise and prayer, Thursday Oasis service, unless it happens to be Connect night, Connect group night. And so you can just put it on. If you don't get a message by text with the opportunity to register for service, don't worry. We can do that at the door. Just come on to the house of the Lord. Be part of what God is doing in this hour. God bless you tonight. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.
Your mercy towards me, Your loving kindness towards me, Your tender mercies I see day after day. Me.